tonight's presenter, Joe Melbert Narvaez, and his presentation titled Black in Hindsight, a review of Black history in Alaska. Joe currently serves as the Diversity and Inclusion Coordinator for the Nanuk Diversity and Action Center at UAF. Within his role, Joe provides university students with personal growth and leadership opportunities in areas of identity, intersectionality, inclusion, equity, and social justice. Before we get started, I just want to remind you of a few things. Please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen if you would like to ask questions that Joe may answer after his presentation. And also, recordings of these presentations are located on the Shine a Light website. The link will be shared with participants in the Q&A as we move through the presentation tonight. So without further ado, Joe, thank you so much for presenting tonight, and I will turn off my camera so you can get started.
Thank you, Margo, and thank you everybody for being here tonight. So Black history in Alaska, from the moment that we stepped on this land to the steps that we're currently taking, has been filled with challenges and victories, tragedies and triumphs, grief and celebration. In spite of and thanks to this history is that we stand here and everywhere strong and proud. I want to thank you all for taking time to be here and listening to what is so often unspoken, and to show that whatever the circumstances that brought us, Black people are here. In a quote from Ian Hartman in their book, Black History in the Last Frontier, African Americans have traveled to Alaska for over 150 years, well before statehood and earlier even in the Klondike Gold Rush. Black people have actively participated in Alaska's politics, economic development, and culture. They've hunted for whales, patrolled the seas, built roads, served in the military, opened businesses, fought injustice, won political office, and forged communities. I would like to disclaim that I'm not a historian, but I am a product of history. It is through my existence and my continued fight that I honor those whose shoulders I stand on and who we all stand on. I will share an abridged version that's not inclusive of all people, places, and events that have brought us here. I hope that we can continue to expand our conversation around our collective history now and from this point forward. So I present to you a timeline where we will see the national context and how Alaskan Black history fits in it. So let's get started. So hundreds of thousands of Africans, both free and enslaved, aided in the establishment of and the survival of colonies in the Americas and the New World. However, many consider a significant starting point to slavery in America to be 1619, when the privateer, the White Lion, brought 20 African slaves ashore the British colony of Jamestown, Virginia. Throughout the 17th century, European settlers in North America turned to enslaved Africans as a cheaper, more plentiful labor source than indentured servants, who were mostly poor Europeans. Though it is impossible to give an accurate figure, some historians have estimated that there are 6 to 7 million enslaved people that were imported into the New World during the 18th century alone, depriving the African continent of some of its healthiest and ablest people. So now we're gonna do a huge time skip and we're going to the 1800s. Harriet Tubman, probably a really well-known and influential leader of our nation. She was a former slave turned abolitionist who bravely risked her life to free both enslaved and her own family members through the Underground Railroad. Her mission was getting as many men, women, and children out of bondage into freedom. When Tubman was a teenager, she acquired a traumatic brain injury when a slave owner struck her in the head. And this resulted in her developing epileptic seizures and hypersomnia. Unfortunately, Tubman's experience of violence occurred on a daily basis, which made her brain injury much worse. It is through determination, courage, and strength that Tubman was able to free many slaves. She did not let her disability keep her or those around her enslaved. So Tubman, as I mentioned earlier, is one of the prominent figures of American history. He was not afraid to be a leader as an African American, as a woman, and as a person with a disability. She's a true hero to us all. And now, how do we get to Alaska? So the 1830s, the number of fugitive slaves who fled the South and ended up whaling in Alaska is impossible to know. But extensive records found in captain logs in New Bedford, Massachusetts provide some insight. So there's documentation that reveals whaling ships that are bound for the North Pacific as early as the 1830s. These ships scoured the waters of the Pacific Northwest and British Columbia, and some made their way as far as Kodiak Island and towards the Aleutians. However, these ships did not come to shore. To do so would have risked conflict with the Russian-American Company, which was then in control of much of the southern and eastern coasts of Alaska. It was common that the whalers would spend their winter in Hawaii before heading north towards the Gulf of Alaska, Bering Strait, or in the Arctic. So the image here shows the Honolulu Harbor in 1856. So while all this is while whaling is happening in the Pacific, we have this ongoing issues. We jump again to the American Civil War and the Constitution. So the Civil War in the United States began in 1861, after decades of simmering tension between the northern and southern states over slavery, states' rights, and westward expansion. The election of Abraham Lincoln in 1860 caused seven southern states to secede and form the Confederate States of America. Four more states would soon join them. The war between states, as the Civil War was also known, ended in Confederate surrender in 1865. The conflict was the costliest and deadliest war ever fought on American soil, with some of 620,000 out of 2.4 million soldiers killed, millions were injured, and much of the South was left in ruins. On December 18, 1865, the 13th Amendment was formally adopted. This one is the first of the Reconstruction Amendments that made slavery illegal in the United States. Then on April 1866, the Civil Rights Act of 1866 was passed, giving citizenship rights to anyone born in the United States. However, civil rights activists at the time were concerned that this act was not a permanent solution and chose to fight for a constitutional amendment. On June 13th, 1866, the 14th Amendment was passed through Congress, though it was not included in the Constitution until July 28th, 1868. Just a fun fact, the last state to ratify the 14th Amendment was Ohio in 2003, 135 years later. Come back to Alaska. So we're now in 1867. Russia controlled most of the area that is now Alaska from the late 1700s until 1867, when it was purchased by the U.S. Secretary of State William Seward for $7.2 million, about 2 cents an acre. At this point, I want to highlight this figure of history, Captain William T. Shorey. Starting in the 1870s, William T. Shorey ascended the ranks of the whaling crews and eventually worked his way up to captain by the early 1900s. He led voyages on multiple whaling vessels, which traveled the Pacific Ocean. It was a notable feat for a man of African descent born to former enslaved parents on a sugar plantation in Barbados. And Shorey's status as one of the era's most skilled whalers was as unlikely as it was remarkable. Here in the image, we see William Shorey and his wife, Julia Ann Shelton Shorey, and daughters, Zenobia Pearl and Victoria. We're now in 1870s. So by the 1870s, American census takers had counted 391 non-native civilians living in Sitka. There were six modest army posts in the territory. Each one was hastily constructed to house servicemen and to provide the United States with a permanent presence in Alaska. These early records shows documents of six Black individuals who were mostly in roles as cooks or bakers, as well as servants. So what is happening in the national context at this point? It is about 10 years after the end of the Civil War. And we now see Jim Crow's America and the segregation of races. So Jim Crow laws were state and local laws that were that enforced racial segregation in the southern states. All were enacted in the late 19th and early 20th century by white Democratic dominated state legislatures after the Reconstruction period. The laws were enforced until 1965, almost 100 years later. So in practice, Jim Crow laws mandated racial segregation in all public facilities in former Confederate states and some other states, starting in the 1870s and 1880s. Jim Crow laws were upheld in cases such as Plessy versus Ferguson, which in which the US Supreme Court laid out its very famous separate but equal legal doctrine for facilities for Black Americans. Moreover, public education had essentially already been segregated since its establishment in the South after the Civil War. Back to Alaska. It is now 1896, and we are during the Klondike Gold Rush. So the Klondike Gold Rush facilitated the largest migration of settlers into Alaska since the United States signed the Treaty of Cession with Russia. As thousands of men and women set out from Seattle, San Francisco, and other locales, the setting became increasingly dangerous and lawless the further north they traveled. The federal government soon sent troops to patrol Skagway and Dyea. Black soldiers were among those first members of the US military to arrive in these towns. The Seattle Post-Intelligencer proclaimed that colored troops to relief soldiers at Wrangell and Dyea on May 14th, 1899. Some of these men saw combat in wars of conquest against the Sioux, the Apache, Cheyenne, and Comanche through the 1870s and 1880s. In the picture, we can see how they were referred to locally as the Buffalo Soldiers. They were preparing halibut for a fresh meal for their army unit. All right, so I launched a lot at you. Don't worry, here's a summary. we start kind of like what we talked about so far from the top and working our way down, and we can see like kind of like what's happening in the national context on the right and what's happening in Alaska on the left and how we can relate those in history. All right, moving on. We are now closing into the 1900s, and I want to also highlight Bessie Kocher. So as tens of thousands of men looked north to make a fortune, women also realized that there's an opportunity to be found in Alaska. In 1896, just as the gold rush began, Bessie Kocher opened her black and white restaurant in Skagway. Her very modest restaurant was the first known black-owned business in Alaska. So here we see a picture of Bessie. And we reach the first World War. So World War I, or the Great War as it was also known, took place between 1914 and 1918. As the people of the United States watched World War I ignite across Europe, African-American citizens saw an opportunity to win the respect of their white neighbors. America was a segregated society, and African-Americans were considered, at best, second-class citizens. Yet despite that, there are many African-American men willing to serve the nation's military. But even as it became apparent that the United States would never enter the war in Europe, Black Americans were still being turned away from military service. When the United States declared war against Germany in April of 1917, the War Department planners quickly realized that the standing of the army, which was at the time 126,000 men, would not be enough to ensure victory overseas. So the standard volunteer system that they had proved to be inadequate in raising an army. So on May 18th, 1917, Congress passed the Selective Service Act, requiring all male citizens between the ages of 21 and 31 to register for the draft. Even before the act was passed, African-American males from all over the country eagerly joined the war efforts. They viewed the conflict as an opportunity to prove their loyalty, their patriotism, their worthiness for equal treatment in the United States. There were a total of four all black regiments, the 9th and the 10th Cavalry, and then the 24th and the 25th Infantry. These men, the men in these units were considered heroes among the black American community. Within 1 week of Wilson's declaration of war, the War Department had to stop accepting black volunteers because they had already met their quota for African Americans in the Army. More than 350,000 African Americans served in segregated units during the World War I, mostly as support troops. Several units saw action alongside French soldiers fighting against Germans, and 171 African Americans were awarded the French Legion of Honor. In response to protests and discrimination and mistreatments from the Black community, several hundred African-American men received officer training in Des Moines, Iowa. And by October 1917, over 600 African-Americans were commissioned as captains and first and second lieutenants. So we are now back in Alaska, kind of like while all this is happening. In 1924, in the final decades of the 19th century and into the 20th century, whalers had pushed further into the Arctic and very nearly exhausted the bowhead population, bringing conflict with the local indigenous populations groups. But in 1924, the last whaling ship set sail from New Bedford, Massachusetts. By then, whaling was no longer considered essential to the economy, being replaced by petroleum, coal, and electricity. Whaling brought more Black people in contact with Alaska and the Pacific Northwest than any other industry during the latter half of the 19th century and the early 20th century. So another time skip, we're in World War II. During World War II, more than 2.5 million African American men registered for the draft, and African American women volunteered in large numbers. When combined with Black women enlisted into the Women's Army Corps, more than 1 million African Americans served the Army during the war. However, Jim Crow laws were still being upheld, and segregated units continued to be the norm. We are now still in the war. In 1941 and 1942, the 95th Engineer Regiment was formed in Virginia and was eventually sent to Canada in 1942 to help build the Alkin Highway. Two other segregated regiments worked on the Alkin, and more than 3,000 young Black men faced up to the challenges that had made the project epic. They had stood up to racism on top of that, and they still delivered, virtually receiving no credit for the contribution. So I want to mention Elizabeth Baradovich, not because she was part of the Black community, but because her work really laid the groundwork for us to continue to fight for civil rights. So Elizabeth Baradovich was a noted Tlingit civil rights leader that went before the Territorial Senate to advocate for Alaska Civil Rights Act, prohibiting racial discrimination in Alaska. It is thanks to House Bill 14, Chapter 2, which is also known as the Anti-Discrimination Act, which was approved on February 16, 1945, as part of the 17th Regulation Session. This act was passed to provide full and equal accommodations, facilities, and privileges to all citizens in places of public accommodation within the jurisdiction of the Territory of Alaska, and to provide penalties for violating. So a few years later, we're in 1948, President Harry Truman issued Executive Order 9981 to end the segregation in the armed forces. So this executive order was meant to abolish discrimination on the basis of race, color, religion, or national origin in the United States Armed Forces, and led to the end of the segregation of the services during the Korean War, which took later 2 years later. We're now in 1953. The legislature passed the Alaska Fair Employment Practices Act, mandating fair employment practices regarding race, religion, color, or nationality. This is 11 years before the Civil Rights Act was passed. All right, again, I have shared a lot of information with you all. So here is a summary of kind of like how everything overlaps, and you can see what's happening on the national context and how what's happening in Alaska is related to it. All right, so we move on. We are now in 1954, and we have the landmark case of Brown versus Board of Education. So Brown v. Board of Education of Topeka was a landmark decision of the US Supreme Court, in which the court ruled that US state laws establishing racial segregation in public schools are unconstitutional, even if the segregated schools are otherwise equal in quality. The court ruled that both Plessy v. Ferguson, which we talked about earlier, that established the separate but equal doctrine, was also unconstitutional, as well as Cumming v. Richmond, which made the separate but equal doctrine apply to schools. We are now in 1955. I want to talk about Emmett Till. Emmett Till was a 14-year-old African-American boy who was lynched in Mississippi in 1955 after being accused of offending a white woman in her family's grocery store. The brutality of his murder and the fact that his killers were acquitted drew attention to the long history of violent persecution of African-Americans in the United States. This was a pivotal moment for the civil rights movement in the later half of the 20th century. So here we see the Montgomery bus boycott. So the courts have ruled that after a year of African-Americans boycotting the Montgomery bus system and facing severe losses, it was passed that segregation in the buses was unconstitutional. And then the moment after that got accepted, then thousands of African Americans in Montgomery the next day were using the bus system, saving the company. We're now in 1960s. The presidential election of 1960 was one of the closest in history. During the campaign, Republican Richard Nixon and Democrat John Kennedy mostly avoided civil rights issues because they were afraid to alienate the Southern voters. In October of that year, civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. was arrested at a sit-in in Atlanta. Word reached the Kennedy campaign and two aides, who were Harris Ford and Sergeant Shivers. And they arranged for the candidate to make a sympathetic call to King's wife, Coretta Scott King. Meanwhile, Robert Kennedy called the judge in this case. So after showing support for the case, traditional support of Black voters for Republican candidates vanished. Kennedy received 68% of the Black vote and won the presidency. We're back in Alaska. It is still 1960s, and it is at this time that Blanca McSmith is the first African-American person appointed to the Alaskan House of Representatives. She had previously helped with the creation of the Anchorage branch of the NAACP in 1951, and as part of the Alaska legislature, she helped Alaska adopt fair housing ordinance and continued to work with the NAACP throughout her career. We are now in 1963 with the famous March on Washington, or the Great March on Washington, as other people call it. It was held in Washington, D.C. on Wednesday, August 28, 1963. The purpose of this march was to advocate for the civil rights and economic rights of African Americans. At the march, final speaker, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., standing in front of the Lincoln Memorial, delivered the historic speech, "I Have a Dream," in which he called for an end to racism. All this work led us to 1964, the Civil Rights Act. The Civil Rights Act of 1964 is a landmark civil rights and labor law in the United States that outlaws discrimination based on race, color, religion, sex, national origin, and later included sexual orientation and gender identity. It prohibits unequal application of voter registration requirements, racial segregation in schools and public accommodations, and employment discrimination. It is considered one of the crowning legislative achievements of the civil rights movement in the later half of the 20th century. So now we come back to Alaska, and it is 1965. So the territorial legislature may have fixed the Anti-Discrimination Act, but as the previous chapter, or as we previously talked about, discrimination stubbornly persisted. Arguably, it grew worse. Housing discrimination intensified in urban Alaska. Their neighborhoods surrounding Anchorage resembled the redlining that communities saw in the north and west of the nation. Leaders such as Willard Bowman and Blanca Miss Smith spoke up about these redlining practices. And despite documented housing segregation in Alaska's largest cities and the turbulent experience of urban renewal, Anchorage remained relatively peaceful throughout the 1960s. And so too did Fairbanks and Juneau. Uprisings on the scale of what Watts, Detroit, Harlem, or Washington, D.C. saw, those never occurred. So in the image, we can see Willard Bowman. At the same time in 1965, throughout March of this year, a group of demonstrators had faced violence as they attempted to march from Selma, Alabama to Montgomery, Alabama, to demand the right to vote for Black people. One of the pivotal days, which was March 7th, was when 17 people were injured by the police, including future Congressman John Lewis. Since that time, March 7th has been known as Bloody Sunday. In March of 1965, more than 1,000 men, women, and children marched from the Anchorage Police Headquarters to the City Hall. And the NAACP wanted to note that the police chief, John Flanagan, had joined them in that march, in solidarity with those who had marched from Selma to Montgomery. The march had been reenacted many times since its anniversary. And in 2015, President Barack Obama marked the 50th anniversary of the march by delivering a speech at the foot of the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma. So we are now in 1969. The Stonewall Riots were a series of spontaneous demonstrations by members of the LGBTQ community in response to a police raid that began in the early morning hours of June 28, 1969, at the Stonewall Inn in the Greenwich Village neighborhood of Manhattan, New York. Marsha P. Johnson was an American queer liberation activist. Known as an outspoken advocate for LGBTQIA plus rights, Johnson was one of the prominent figures in the Stonewall Uprising of 1969. As a founding member of the Gay Liberation Front, Johnson co-founded the Gay and Transvestite Advocacy Organization, or as their acronym is, STAR, alongside with a close friend and also trans woman of color, Sylvia Rivera. A popular figure in New York's gay scene and art scene, Johnson modeled for Andy Warhol and performed on stage with the drag performance troupe Hot Peaches, known for decades as a welcoming presence in the streets of Greenwich Village. Johnson was also known as the mayor of Christopher Street. From 1987 through 1992, Johnson was an AIDS activist with ACT UP. Also, fun fact, at UAF, we have a gender diverse and an LGBTQ inclusive living learning community who is what it, that is named Stonewall after the Stonewall riots and the Stonewall Inn. We're now in 1970 and we are back in Alaska. Y'all remember we had already met Willard Bowman, but in 1970, Willard Bowman and Joshua Wright are elected to the Alaska legislature from Anchorage. And they are the first Black men to be elected to state office. 7 years prior, the governor, William Egan, had appointed Willard Bowman to head up the Alaska Commission on Human Rights. So here in the image, we can see Governor William Egan signing the Human Rights Act with Willard Bowman and Maria Bowman. All right, talked a lot again, promise. I have a lot of summaries like this. You can see kind of like what's happening in this particular part. I've broken down and focused a little bit more on the civil rights, on those 10 years of the civil rights movement. And to see like what's happening in Alaska. All right, it is now 1971 and we are in upstate New York. The Attica State Correctional Facility was overcrowded and the conditions for prisoners were inhumane. And the majority of these prisoners were racial and ethnic minorities. A group of 5 prisoners representing the inmate population has sent a letter to the authorities requesting reform, including humble changes such as more frequent showers and more toilet paper. At the time, the inmates were allotted 1 bucket of water a week as a quote unquote shower and given only 1 bar of soap and 1 roll of toilet paper a month. The prisoners also asked for more visits and less censorship in their mail. The new commissioner of the correctional services, Russell Oswald, asked for more time to make the reforms, but understanding that Oswald's reply were more of a delaying tactic, the prisoners took over the facility on September 9th and kept 40 guards as hostages. One guard, injured during the uprising, died during the hospital. After 4 days of negotiations, state troopers and correctional officers took the prison back by force, killing 10 hostages and 29 inmates, and brutalizing other inmates that they had captured. So it is now 1972 and we are back in Alaska. Selwyn George Carroll was an American politician who served as a member of the Alaska Representatives from 1972 to 1974. Carroll was a native of Altamonte Springs in Florida, and he had settled in Fairbanks, Alaska in 1966, and was a social worker that was affiliated with the Alaska Department of Public Welfare on August 1967. And that was all before he joined the Department of Corrections as a supervisor in the Youth Detention Center in the Alaska State Jail. Carroll was hired by the Fairbanks North Star Borough School District in 1970 as an attendance officer, and then later served the district as a middle school teacher. Carroll became the first African-American member of the Alaska legislature to be affiliated with the Republican Party. All right, we are now in 1983, and we are in, I'm not exactly sure where we're at, but it's in the national context. So I wanted to highlight Dr. Daniel Hale Williams. So Dr. Williams performed the first successful open heart surgery in 1983, and founded the Providence Hospital and Training School for Nurses, which is the first Black-owned hospital in America in 1981. From 1983 to 1988, he was a surgeon in chief of the Freedmen Hospital in Washington, D.C. He also founded the National Medical Association in 1985, and African Americans were denied membership or the reason that he founded the Medical Association, or the National Medical Association, was because African Americans were denied membership of the American Medical Association. As a charter member of the American College of Surgeons, he was also the first and only African American member for many years. All right, it is now 1984 and we are back in Alaska. So originally from New Jersey, Rex Butler became a legislative aide for the Alaska State Senator Joe Josephson. Butler had then worked as an assistant attorney general for the Alaska Department of Laws, Division of Consumer Protection in Anchorage. He also served as general counsel for the Reverend Jesse Jackson, senior for the President's Committee in Alaska, and as the president of the Federal Bar Association Alaska chapter. Butler founded the Rex Lamont Butler and Associates Inc. in 1985, and he has worked as a criminal attorney defense. The reason I want to highlight Butler because Butler was a recipient of the Martin Luther King Jr. Community Service Award, which is a public service award from the Anchorage Mayor Tony Knowles, and a certificate of appreciation from the Anchorage Equal Rights Commission. From this point on, I just want to highlight a lot of prominent folks who are either the first or have contributed a lot to American history. It's not like an exhaustive list, but I hope that we can all continue this conversation. So Gwendolyn Brooks becomes the first Black person to be named the U.S. Poet Laureate. Brooks, also the first African-American to win a Pulitzer Prize in 1950, produces work that describes ordinary Black people in bold, innovative, and beautiful verse, and often draws on the Bronzeville neighborhood of Chicago where she lived most of her life. Oh, sorry about that. That is Aretha Franklin. I did not update the name. But American singer and activist Aretha Franklin becomes the first woman to be introduced into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And she goes on to be awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom, which was presented to her in 2005 by President George W. Bush, and to later sing America at the inauguration of President Obama in 2009. So we are now back in Alaska in 1984. And more closely, we are at the University of Alaska. So Joe L. Hayes Jr. is an American businessman and politician that's born in Manhattan in 1970. After serving in the United States Air Force stationed in Allison Air Force Base, Hayes enrolled as a political science major here at the University of Alaska Fairbanks campus. Also, after being elected UAF's first Black student body president, he was elected by the Alaska governor to serve as student regent for the UA Board of Regents. Hayes served his term from 1995 to 1997. And in the year 2000, he served as a member of the Alaskan House of Representatives and served until 2003. All right, we broke the millennia. We are in the year 2000. And I want to highlight Betty Davis. So after serving on the Alaska State House for 6 years, Betty Davis becomes the first African-American state senator in Alaska. And she continues with the legislature through 2013. All right, here's another summary of what's going on and what we just talked about. As you can see, we still have a lot going on in the national context, but we're still making history here. All right. So now we are in 2008, closer to our collective memory. And I want to introduce Cal Williams. So Cal Williams had been the president of the NAACP in Alaska, and he was a member of the 2008 Alaska delegation at the National Democratic Convention in Colorado. And in 2018, he served as the District 22 chair for the Alaska Democratic Party. In the national context, running on a platform of change, Illinois Senator Barack Obama wins the 2008 presidential election to become the first person of African descent chosen to run the United States. A multiracial, multi-generational coalition of volunteers helped Obama win the campaign. Considering that African Americans were previously denied the right to vote, forcibly segregated from whites and enslaved in the United States, Obama's successful presidential bid marked a turning point for the nation. Anti-racist activists take issue with the notion that Obama's election meant that we are now living in a post-racial America, because the gaps between Black and Black people and white people remain in education, employment, and healthcare sectors, to name a few. 4 years later, it is 2012, and we have a historic moment in the Olympics. Gabrielle Douglas is a U.S. women's artistic gymnast. At the 2012 London Summer Olympics, she won gold medals in both the team and individual all-around competition. Gabrielle is the first woman of color of any nationality and the first African-American gymnast in Olympic history to become the individual all-around champion. She is also the first American gymnast to win gold in both the gymnastic individual all-around and the team competitions in the same Olympic Games. It is 2013 and we are back in Alaska. And I wanna highlight UAAA graduate, Michelle Taylor. So Michelle Taylor graduated high school within the top 10th percentile of students and majored in hotel and restaurant management at UAA. Michelle, sorry about that, I see the typo, yes. Thank you. Michelle was the first African-American woman to become Miss Alaska. Despite there being backlash from some Alaskans. She then went on to compete for Miss America. Okay. So it is we're in 2013, and after the death of several Black teens, the hashtag Black Lives Matter begins the movement. BLM is now a prominent decentralized social justice organization working towards social justice for Black lives. It is 2017, and since August of 2016, professional athletes have protested against police brutality and racism by taking a knee during the national anthem. The protest began in the National Football League, NFL, after San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick sat and later knelt during the anthem before his team's preseason games of 2016. Throughout the following seasons, members of various NFL and other sports teams have engaged in similar silent protests. On September 24th of 2017, the NFL protest became more widespread when over 200 players sat or knelt in response to President Trump's calling for owners to fire the protesting players. Now we come back to Fairbanks, Alaska. It is 2019 and started by local educator and human rights activist Virgie Delnat Kane in 1987, the African American Student Leadership Conference aims to give middle and high school students in the North Star Borough an opportunity to engage with Black role models as well as develop their leadership skills. This conference takes place in the fall every year, except this fall because, well, COVID. And it is hosted here at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. Dunlap King also inspired the creation of the Virgie Dunlap King Academy for Social Change that's available to all UAF students. The first cohort for this academy began their journey in fall 2019. And we currently have an active cohort. All right. We're in the dreaded year. It is 2020, and COVID has changed the way that we live, that we all live, and promises to continue to do so today. multiple analyses of available federal and state and local data show that people of color are experiencing a disproportionate burden of COVID-19 cases and deaths. 2020 also saw the murders of Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, and Ahmaud Arbery. The murders of Breonna, George, and Ahmaud in the first half of 2020 have sparked outrage and rekindled the fight for racial justice in the United States. On February 23rd, 2020, Ahmaud Marquez Arbery, and an unarmed 25-year-old Black man, was pursued and fatally shot while jogging near Brunswick in Glynn County, Georgia. Breonna Taylor, a 26-year-old African-American woman, was fatally shot in her Louisville, Kentucky apartment on March 13th when white plainclothes officers Jonathan Mattingly, Brett Hankinson, and Miles Crossgrove of the Louisville Metro Police Department forced entry into the apartment as part of an investigation into a drug dealing operation. George Floyd was an African-American man that was killed during an arrest after a store clerk alleged he had passed a counterfeit $20 bill in Minneapolis. Derek Chauvin, one of the four police officers who arrived at the scene, knelt on Floyd's neck for a period initially reported to be 8 minutes and 46 seconds. In 2020, we also saw the presidential election. And Kamala Devi Harris is an American politician and attorney that is currently serving as the 49th Vice President of the United States. And she's the United States' first female vice president, the highest ranking female official in the US history, and the first African-American and first Asian-American vice president. Here is a summary of what we just talked about. I hope I don't have any more typos. It's a lot of numbers. All right, so thank you all for bearing with me. I share this history with you, not because I can, but because it is necessary for us to know where we have been, to know where we're going. By acknowledging and teaching about the people, places, and events that have brought us to this point, we can nurture future generations of empathy, equipped to be better than we ever were. I leave you all with this quote from the legendary Frederick Douglass. It is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that presentation, Joe, and thank you for that walk through history nationally and in relation to what is going on in Alaska. We actually have some questions for you that I'd like to go through. The first question is, looking historically, you had shown pictures of Black men in the military and then later talked about Black women serving. So the question is, the military was an important institution for Black settlement in Alaska. How would you characterize the relationship between Black settlers and the military service?
For that question, I think it depends on the time that we're talking about. I think that when we think about our current relationship, a lot of our African-American people that arrive in Alaska today come through military service, and they see it as an opportunity. Some don't see it as an opportunity. They see it as like, why are we sent to this cold place? However, I definitely think that ever since the African-American population have been free from slavery, they've been willing to participate and defend the country and prove themselves loyal and contributing members of the United States. So I think the relationship is a little bit complicated. And I know it's not like an excellent answer to that question, but I definitely think that if you ask any person why they're in the military and what brings them, or any Black person, why they're in the military, their answer might be different.
Thank you. Do you have thoughts about how an authentic and inclusive history can be delivered through our Alaskan elementary and secondary educational system?
Absolutely. I definitely think that I think we need to review our curriculum. And I think it's important for us to acknowledge that our curriculum, or specifically our history curriculum, is not necessarily inclusive of like all the important contributions of not only Black people, but also Indigenous folks, Asian folks. And with that, usually we are learning about these things in a separate class that is voluntary. However, as I talked about earlier in when I introduced Frederick Douglass, I think it's important for us to teach this to all of our students because we need to know the history, the whole history of the United States, in order for us to be able to be truly empathetic and understand what's going on and the nuances and the context in which we all live. So as far as a suggestion on how we can create an authentic and inclusive history, I think we just need to take into account who's at the table making these curricular decisions. And are these people represented? And if they're not here, how can we as allies then make sure that they are represented and heard?
Thank you. What are some ways you'd recommend people celebrate Black History Month or stand up for equity today?
Well, I think that the best thing is to first acknowledge it and recognize that Black history is American history. It's all of our history. I wish that we lived in a future or in a time that Black History Month was not like necessary. It is not compartmentalized into this month, but it's also included in like, every time that we talk about history, everybody is represented. As far as like, how can we celebrate Black History Month? I would say just stay in tune. There are a lot of local organizations that are doing some great events, some great learning opportunities. If you work in the school district or a teacher or anything like that, making sure that the students, you know, are exposed to this history in ways that are engaging and fun. I remember when I was a student, history was like probably not my favorite subject, but it absolutely something that was probably because I didn't feel that I was represented in that history that I was being taught. I didn't have any good role models to look up to in history, or I wasn't taught any good role models. It was always something that I had to search on my own. So as far as celebrating, just supporting local organizations that are doing the work, having conversations about it. I think that the media and technology is catching up, but there's so many documentaries, and I would just take this month as an opportunity to learn and build our own capacity to engage in conversations around equity, around social justice, around kind of like what has brought us to be here today.
Thank you so much, Joe. That is it for our questions today. So we hope you will continue to join us monthly for our presentations. Please keep an eye out for recordings of our presentations on upcoming topics featured on our Shine a Light series at the website nwc.uaf.edu. You're also welcome to ask further questions, give feedback, or request participation in these series by visiting that website and filling out our Google form. Joe, again, thank you so much. And we'd like to thank the attendees for joining us this evening. And this concludes our presentation.